Good morning, everyone. At the outset, I must thank Madam Padma Gunaratna, President Sri Lanka Medical Association, and our President, Dr. Satish Harishchandra, and both councils, and especially Dr. Madhuvanthi, for giving me this wonderful opportunity to talk to you today. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll start from a MCQ in the morning. Let's try and answer this question. True or false regarding blood pressure management. One, hypertension mediated organ damage affect cardiac perfusion during surgery. Number two, preoperative blood pressure of 210 over 110 needs to be controlled with intravenous drugs. Number three, postoperative fourth day blood pressure of 170 to over 100 needs to be treated with drugs. Number four, bisoprolol should be stopped preoperatively in a patient with ischemic heart disease or angina. Number five, losartan can be stopped day before the surgery if the blood pressure control is optimal. So with these questions in our mind, let's try to find answers to these questions at the end of the presentation. So this brings me to the talk today, perioperative management of hypertension. This is the outline of my talk. I would speak about importance, blood pressure response, risk assessment, and so on and so forth during this 20-minute talk. Importance. Blood pressure is one of the major determinants of hemodynamic stability, as all of us know. And intraoperative and postoperative blood pressure will affect organ perfusion during this period. So intraoperative and postoperative blood pressure are influenced, in fact, by many factors, mainly surgery, anesthesia, drugs, and not only that, the preoperative blood pressure also influence the blood pressure during the surgery and even post-op period. And hypertension-mediated organ damage can affect cardiac perfusion during surgery. So there are so many things need to be optimum before the patient goes into surgery and even after to have a safe post-op period. Therefore, optimal management of hypertension in the perioperative period prevent undesirable patient outcomes. So that it's really, really important for us to discuss about this important topic. So Anesthesia Journal 1996 reported this study, hypertension, admission, blood pressure, and perioperative cardiovascular risk. The patients who died of a cardiovascular cause within 30 days of a surgery, they had two groups, 76 with pre-surgical hypertension and 76 with normotensive patients. So preoperative hypertension was four times more likely than among matched controls. So patients who had some cardiac event and death had a preoperative hypertension as a history. So this denotes the importance of managing preoperative and perioperative hypertension well. What happened to the blood pressure during anesthesia? So during induction, sympathetic activation happens, and therefore blood pressure would be going up with the heart rate. And during anesthesia, what happens is that mean artery pressure falls because of vasodilatation and all, and intraoperative hypertension could set in. And in recovery, again, the blood pressure and heart rate would rise back. And these changes are, in fact, more pronounced in untreated hypertension, people with untreated hypertension and pre-existing hypertension. So what would happen with these pronounced changes is that they all will cause myocardial ischemia during the surgery and even after the surgical period. Right. Surgery and cardiac risk. Physiologic factors now, not only the anesthesia, the surgery itself affects the blood pressure and it affects the cardiac health during the surgery. So physiology factors associated with surgery predispose to myocardial ischemia, like volume shifts and blood losses. And enhanced myocardial oxygen demand because of the high catecholamine release as of the stressful condition. And then only in the post-operative period, we have aggravated activity of platelet activity. And therefore, cardiac ischemia could set in. And these all effects are more pronounced in patients with coronary artery disease and hypertension. So cardiac risk of surgery, in fact, is increased by having hypertension-mediated organ damage, like cerebrovascular and coronary occlusive disease. If the patient has already set in coronary vascular disease, when the hypertension sets in, so the cardiac perfusion go down. Not only that, diastolic dysfunction from left ventricular hypertrophy, congestive heart failure and renal impairment, all could cause increased risk of surgery. Therefore, overall preoperative cardiovascular risk assessment, including search for HMOD, is important in treated and untreated hypertensive patients. Now it's time to discuss about the blood pressure goals. So what is the goal for preoperative blood pressure? It's 180 over 110. So in those with systolic blood pressure more than 180 and 110, there's no urgency to do the surgery unless it's an emergency situation. So you could postpone it and control the blood pressure and you can do the surgery later. But the target is 180 over 110. Sorry about this. So British Journal of Anesthesia in 1971 reports this study. Patients with untreated severe hypertension, that means systolic and diastolic pressures over 211 and 2105, and had exaggerated hypotensive response to the induction of anesthesia and marked hypotensive response to noxious stimuli. So meaning that they could have serious cardiac outcomes during this period. This is another study reported in Medical Clinics of North America. Diastolic pressure over 110 immediately before the surgery is associated with number of complications, including dysarrhythmias, myocardial ischemia and infarction, neurologic complications, and renal failure. Let's move to intraoperative blood pressure goal. Well, there's no fixed target there. It's the teaching is avoid large intraoperative blood pressure fluctuations. JAMA reported this effect of individualized versus standard blood pressure management strategies on postoperative organ dysfunction. So when the blood pressure values are kept within 10% of difference from the preoperative blood pressure, resulted in reduced risk of postoperative organ dysfunction. Our anesthetic colleagues are trying their level best to do this by using volume expanders, inotrope, vasopressors and all to keep this range within 10%. Postoperative blood pressure goal is actually similar to general population. So if the postoperative blood pressure is more than 180 and 110, we need to see whether it's due to severe pain. If it is not, it is a medical emergency. You need to bring this blood pressure down with intravenous antihypertensive therapy. But if it is less than 110, 180, 110, the management would differ whether the patient had hypertension before or was de novo hypertension. Let's say the patient hasn't had pre-existing hypertension. We need to exclude or treat pain, agitation, hypercarbia, hypoxia, hypovolemia, and bladder distension, which all could contribute to blood pressure, elevation of blood pressure. In the absence of those with the elevated blood pressure, you need to start drugs And you could discontinue these drugs once the patient is stable surgically. And perhaps you need to resume these therapies if the blood pressure keep remaining elevated after 72 hours. In the case of pre-existing hypertension, patient who had been on drugs, then you could resume the usual medications post-operatively as needed. Now we discuss about the antihypertensive medications during perioperative period. There are a few important facts to remember. Most continued until the time of surgery, taken with small sips of water in the morning of surgery. So there's no problem in it. Most of the drug, but there are some exceptions which I will elaborate on next slides. And drug treatment used previously will need review prior to surgery. That has to be done. There is no clear evidence support the use of one class versus another. An individualized approach to managing hypertension perioperatively may require you to conflicting data on safety of several antihypertensives. So individualized approach has to be done, whatever the case. About calcium channel blockers. In fact, calcium channel blockers are the safer option to be given in perioperative period, among the others. But they may have increased incidence of postoperative bleeding, probably due to inhibition of platelet aggregation. However, benefits outweighs the risk. So you can start or continue calcium channel blockers during perioperative period. Moving to the next slide, diuretics. Diuretics also can be used, but of course we know they can cause some problems, especially electrolyte imbalance, hypokalemia. If that happens during the surgery, that may potentiate the effects of muscle relaxants used during anesthesia. It might predispose to cardiac arrhythmias as well. And you need to think about volume and potassium replacement in any case. Next slide. About beta blockers. Well, beta blockers have potential beneficial effects as well as adverse effects. So beneficial effects, it reduces the ischemia by decreasing myocardial oxygen demand due to increased catecholamine release in this stressful situation. It helps to prevent control arrhythmia, especially in cardiac surgeries. And potential adverse effects are, it's very known fact that, well-known fact that it can cause bradycardia and hypertension during the surgery. And not only that, withdrawal syndrome is another problem. If you stop this beta blockers in a patient who's been taking it for long for angina or ischemic heart disease, then they can have rebound ischemia during the surgery. However, it's less common with people who have been taking these drugs for migraine prophylaxis and hypertension itself. Literature about beta blockers, there are so many conflicting evidences. So this is the Hart reports this study, meta-analysis, RCTs of beta blockade. The conclusion was increasing the risk of hypertension, stroke, and mortality in patients preoperative beta blockers versus placebo. So if the patient has been on beta blockers preoperatively and your mortality is high, that is what was reported in 2014. In 2018, Cochrane review. Next slide. About perioperative beta blockers for preventing surgery-related mortality and morbidity. In non-cardiac surgery, they concluded shows an association of beta blockers with increased all-cause mortality. They again stayed in that stance that the beta blockers has an association with increased mortality and suggest an increase in stroke rate with the use of beta blockers as well. But more evidence is needed before a definitive conclusion can be drawn. So, and then substantial reduction of ventricular arrhythmia, supraventricular arrhythmias, and acute MIs in this setting offsets by potential increase in mortality and stroke. In cardiac surgery, of course, this is about non-cardiac surgery. Cardiac surgery, this prevention of MIs and arrhythmias is a significant thing. Moving to the next slide, the Cochrane review in 2019, however, they conclude the evidence for really early all-cause mortality with perioperative beta blockade was uncertain, and no evidence of a difference in cerebrovascular events or ventricular arrhythmias. And they also concluded that further evidence from large placebo-controlled trials is likely to make this clearer. And in fact, there are so many trials being planned and under review to come to conclusion in this effect. So beta blockers, perioperative continuation of beta blocker is recommended in hypertensive patients currently on chronic beta blocker treatment. So if the patient had been on beta blockers for long, especially for angina, ischemic heart disease, you could consider in continuing them. However, starting a beta blocker on the day of surgery, however, can be avoided because of the problems of intrasurgical hypotension and bradycardia and stroke rates. Moving into AC inhibition and ARB blockers, theoretically, they blunt the compensatory activation of renin-angiotensin system during surgery, and that can result in prolonged hypotension. That is a serious problem. In fact, several studies have reported high incidence of hypotension actually with AC inhibition and ARB blockers. So this study, Anesthesiology 2017, continuing AC inhibition or blocker before non-cardiac surgery. So withholding associated with the lower risk of death and postoperative vascular events. A large randomized trial is needed to confirm this finding. So in the interim, in the setting of this finding, clinicians should consider recommending that patients withhold AC inhibition or ARB 24 hours before surgery, unless there is a very compelling reason to have it on board. So transient preoperative discontinuation should be considered unless there's a compelling reason to continue them, like such as heart failure, or can be resumed safely as early as second postoperative day. That is no problem. Right, ladies and gentlemen, we'll try to answer these questions now. Hypertension mediated organ damage affects cardiac perfusion during surgery. We discussed when you have this damaged vessels, hypotension and perfusion issues might be there for the heart during the surgery. So that's true. And preoperative blood pressure of 210-110 need to be controlled with intravenous drugs. Well, that is not a medical emergency, to be honest. You can postpone the surgery and you can control the blood pressure by giving oral drugs and then do the surgery unless it's an emergency. So it's false. And postoperative fourth day blood pressure, 107 over 100, needs to be treated with drugs. Is it true or false? Well, we said if the blood pressure is persistently high after 72 hours, then you might consider starting treating the blood pressure with drugs. So it's true. Bisoprolol should be stopped preoperatively in patient with ischemic heart disease. Well, when the patient has been on beta blockers for long, then if you stop it all of a sudden, it can cause rebound ischemia, that is called withdrawal syndrome. So you might not do this intervention. So losartan can be stopped day before the surgery if the blood pressure control is optimal. Continuing losartan, of course, we know can cause some problems, especially blocking of renin-angiotensin system and causing intraoperational hypotension. So if the preoperative blood pressure is optimal without losartan, you may stop this drug. Otherwise, you can continue it. So it's true. Right, in summary, optimum management of hypertension in the perioperative period will prevent undesirable outcomes. Preoperative blood pressure goal is 110 over 180 over 110. So you can postpone the surgery unless it's emergency. Postoperative blood pressure more than 180-110 is a medical emergency and need urgent treatment. In patient with pre-existing hypertension, resume their usual medication postoperatively as needed. There's no problem. Most drugs can be continued, but some have some limitations. However, there are no clear evidence support to use one class versus another. Calcium channel blockers are the safest among all, and perioperative continuation of beta blockers is recommended in patients currently on chronic beta blocker treatment. Otherwise, it can cause rebound ischemia. And transient perioperative discontinuation of AC inhibition aiming to reduce intraoperative hypertension should be considered before non-cardiac surgery. I would like to thank again all of you and President Sri Lanka Medical Association and Sri Lanka College of Internal Medicine for giving this opportunity for me. Thank you very much.